It's late January 1983, and in Nigeria, the president, Shehu Shagari, has suddenly announced that all foreigners without the right paperwork have just weeks to leave the country. Almost all are West African, the majority are Ghanaian.
If they don't leave, they should be arrested and tried and sent back to their homes. Illegal immigrants, in fact, under normal circumstances, should not be given any notice whatsoever. If you break a law, then you have to pay for it.
In Lagos, a Ghanaian, Charles Ekowotu, is working as an assistant sales manager for a chemical firm, but technically he is an illegal immigrant.
Someone told me there was a deadline that minister will hand over every power to every civilian, that every civilian can do anything to any alien in the country.
And it was that threat, any Nigerian citizen can take action against...
Oh yes, when the deadline expires, he will be giving the power to every Nigerian, every citizen. You have nowhere to hide in Nigeria, because wherever you are staying with a Nigerian. So that made everyone scared.
Across Nigeria, up to 2 million migrants heeded the warnings. They packed what they could into trucks, cars, pickups and taxis and tried to get out of the country. The main route home to Ghana was west through the tiny neighbouring states of Benin and Togo. Charles and his friends hired a car and headed to the border. It was only when they left Lagos they realised the scale of the exodus.
So when we hit the main road, there we could see the seriousness of the whole thing. Trucks loaded with items and people. Thousands of vehicles. And the people, you know, is uncountable. Thousands and thousands of people. Millions.
A BBC correspondent followed the refugees.
With more than 2 million illegal immigrants ordered to get out of Nigeria, the resulting chaos is staggering. Hundreds of thousands have now massed at Nigeria's frontier with the tiny West African state of Benin.
When we were about to reach Benin, that's the worst situation. I could say about 2 kilometers to the border. People have been camping here, both sides of the street or the road. Some having no water, some are in good mood, others are even... And some have stayed there so long that they have run out of money.
Many families are stranded. Overladen lorries, cars or taxis have brought them this far. But now they camp out in the hope of being able to complete their journeys home. Among the exiles are at least 1 million Ghanaians.
The majority of the Ghanaian migrants were drawn to Nigeria during the oil boom of the 70s. But by 1983, the Nigerian economy was suffering and it was an election year. Nigerian politicians hoped the expulsion would prove popular. Those with longer memories remembered that Ghana had expelled Nigerian migrants in 1969, but the scale this time was unprecedented.
Because of the traffic, the cars are piled up bumper to bumper. During the night, people have generators and all these things, and there's music. And
so people set up music and bars by the
camps,
side of the road?
Yeah, yeah. That, as at that, we know this Bob Marley, Peter Tosh, and movement of Jah people.
But once in Benin, there were not many ways out.
Those who've managed to reach Benin are besieging the main port at Cotonou in the hope of catching a boat to Ghana. The queue is several miles long.
I met a friend about to board a ship, and there was this stampede and he fell. So he had a fracture, which was a very serious one.
The main problem was that following an attempted coup the previous year, Ghana's leader, Jerry Rawlings, had closed the main land crossing with Togo. And so, to avoid being host to a sudden influx of over 1 million migrants, Togo, in turn, shut its border with Benin. That left Ghanaian refugees stuck again.
Tens of thousands of refugees, mostly Ghanaians, amassed here at the border of the two tiny West African states of Benin and Togo. The road home to Ghana has come to a standstill, hopelessly clogged with vehicles and a seething mass of refugees, while the frontier remains temporarily closed.
Finally, Ghana relented and opened its border. Togo followed suit.
Within minutes of the frontier reopening, there was chaos. Many families had been waiting 10 days to walk the 50 yards or so from Benin into Togo.
When you reach the borders, all our people get down. So we'll be walking through, but there's nothing like they'll be checking your passport or anything of that sort. Some of other people are finding it very difficult because they have a lot of personal belongings.
Were you angry at your treatment that this had all happened? Or were you frustrated?
Frustration set in, but whom will you be angry with? It's a general thing. I know a lot of people blame the then government that even when your people have been repatriating, you still close the border, and some of them have been there for 2 months and then and over. And what sort of leadership is that? But when we reach Ghana, I could remember we have to go and look for coconut because that is only available food you could find at the border towns. You know, at the border towns, too, things are very expensive.
And in the haste to get home, some returning refugees were knocked off the back of packed lorries.
We have these overhead bridges. You could see on top of the bridges some blood have scattered all over. Meaning when they are coming during the night, articulated trucks, the inner part of it has been filled with personal belongings. So they were sitting at the edges of the trucks, and some of them would be hitting their head against the overhead bridges, which means there are a lot of people who die even on their road to Ghana.
There had been real fears that Ghana, whose population was then around 12 million, could not cope with such an influx. Its economy was already in crisis. There were shortages, there were bushfires and drought. And yet, across the country, the refugees were absorbed by their communities. Charles returned to his father's village.
Oh, it was a very big welcome. And they were relieved. Yeah, quite relieved.
And did you ever go back to Nigeria?
No. When I crossed Togo border, I swear to myself I won't get back to. Even if I have to travel, it won't be Nigeria. You never return to Nigeria.
But within the year, tens of thousands had returned to Nigeria, and there was another, much smaller round of expulsions 2 years later. But relations between the two countries did finally improve. Today, there remains a small, everyday reminder of the exodus. Ghana Must Go is the name given to the huge, cheap, checkered hold-all bags used by Ghanaian refugees 30 years ago, which are still very popular today. That's all for this edition of the Witness podcast with me, Alex Last. We have hundreds more episodes for you to listen to.